to the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network.
Now let's do this!
It's just two men cheating the system by actually getting paid to talk sports.
You volunteered, didn't you? We're paying you, aren't we?
Good thing they like being heard, because we don't pay them that much.
It's like people only do things because they get paid, and that's just really sad.
The first of the duo is never shy about letting you know where he stands.
Okay, hot take, but I like your confidence.
The other promises he'll grow on you with time.
It's like a new pair of underwear. At first, it's constrictive, but after a while, it becomes a part of you.
Together, they're bringing you the best in Oklahoma State sports talk and their opinions on sports topics from around the country.
That's right. Listen up. Hey, listen up. You.
Patrick Wheeler.
Let's stomp these dudes.
And Zach Lancaster.
Everyone is stupid except me.
This is the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network.
That's what I'm talking about. Sports.
You ain't never heard nothing like this. Let me work. Show me where the mic is. I'm on stage, black shirt and my Timbs. You know how I do it. I ain't playing with you. I've been grinding. Anybody trying to sleep on me? Better do something with your eyes.
This is the Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Kicking off a brand new week. So much to get to today. Oklahoma State football gets the win in a wild game with Texas Tech. OSU basketball 2-0. Been a while since we've been on. Patrick Wheeler here, and back in action, the man, the myth, the legend, Zach Lancaster is back joining me as well. Zach, it has been a while, my man, but it is so good to have you back. What's going on?
What is up, man? It's good to be back. I've been looking forward to this moment for what? 3 weeks now?
3 weeks, and it seems like about 4 or 5 months. I'm going to be honest with you. But yeah.
Oh, yeah. Trust me, I know the feeling.
Yes, you definitely do. I'll have you know that, when I was on by myself, I never really dove too deep into what was going on. Just let everybody know, well, Zach's not feeling well, and he's still out, and it's just going to be me for today. And of course, we had a bunch of different people on and filling in some spots, so we appreciate everything everybody else did, but glad to have you back as always. And again, I want to make sure before we get too deep into anything, our show brought to you today by Advantage Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling. This is the time to get in there at Advantage and make sure that your heating system, your furnace is good to go. It's about to get cold here in Oklahoma, and you do not want to mess around with this. It'll be too late before you know it. You wake up one morning, you're freezing because your furnace is messed up. Don't wait. Don't even risk it. Give Advantage a call at 533-2483, or you can visit them at youneedadvantage.com, 1521 East 6th here in Stillwater. So, Zach, before we get into Oklahoma State football, that stuff, you want to let everybody know how you've been able to kind of come back from where you were?
Yeah, man. So it what's crazy is it all started the day after I came back to the show. So I got we started that Monday. That Tuesday, I had a little tickle in my throat. No big deal. I honestly chalked it up to being back on the radio. That's the most I've talked consecutively in a while. So I was like, oh, well, my throat's just tired. My voice is tired, whatever. Wednesday, a little more pronounced. I've had some sinus pressure. Great. Okay. Well, I'm getting a cold or something. Thursday, I wake up with a low grade fever and I felt fine. But I could barely taste my coffee, which is not great. But then I popped a cough drop, and my taste and smell and all that stuff was good. So I was like, oh, well, it just cleared out my head. And as Thursday progressed, I was worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And by that evening, I was running a 101 fever. And then it just downhill from there. I got tested on Friday. The health department called me on Sunday, positive for COVID. Don't know how I got it. Don't know where I got it. It's a complete mystery. By Wednesday, about 2 o'clock in the morning, get up to take some more medicine, pass out in the bathroom, crack my head on the wall, horrible stuff. I have to go to the emergency room for about 5 or 6 hours, severely dehydrated. And then Thursday, I'm running a 104.6 fever, burning up. So I jump in the shower to try to cool off. get out, can't catch my breath. My wife, Andrea, is a nurse. She checked my pulse ox. It's down to 81. Can't breathe. My hands are starting to tingle. My toes are tingling. My fingernails are turning purple. Andrea takes me to the hospital. I get really lucky because I get the last emergency room bed, and then I got the last COVID bed. They admitted me to the hospital that night, and I spent 8 days. The first 3 days were really hairy. Body was really inflamed. I guess the numbers are supposed to be really, really low, and mine were super, super high, like over 900. And then blood clot numbers are supposed to be between like 1 and 5 or something, and mine was a 33. So fought blood clots, fought inflammation, fought pneumonia. Doctors said they, like, any one of the first 3 days, it very possible that I could have died. And then the doctor told my wife that if I would have stayed home, that I probably would have died here at the house over the weekend. So, but I got to give all the credit in the world to the Stillwater Medical Center. They were phenomenal. The doctors, the nurses, they had me on the plasma that night, had me on all the right medicine. I mean, they brought me back, literally brought me back from death's doorstep. So, all the credit in the world. And if anyone takes anything away, I'm not going to get political. I don't want to get political. But if anyone takes anything away from what I went through, please just stay away from large crowds, wash your hands, wear your masks, just be safe. Because I can't even begin to describe how horrible it was. Not even just the sickness, but you're so isolated. That you start, you know, the depression sets in. And by the end of it, I was like, if they would have made me stay another day, I would have checked myself out. Like, I couldn't take it anymore. It was so, so horrible. So please, everyone, just be safe. Take your precautions, social distance, and please just be safe.
There you go, man. That's wild. That is a wild story, mm-hmm. No doubt. But
well, and what's crazy is my wife tested positive, and nothing happened. You know, she had a little bit of a runny nose and some body aches and a little bit of drainage, and she was better in about 2 or 3 days. So it's insane how it works.
Yeah, it's really different for a lot of people, no doubt. And that's why it can be, you know, such an issue and so confusing. But it is, like I said, very good to have you back. We're glad you made it through.
Absolutely.
Feeling better. Yeah, and you know what? We can flip it over here because we have good news to talk about.
You
know, it's actually, how many games did Oklahoma State effectively play before we've talked about it? Was Bedlam? I know it was Bedlam, but was the game before that? Did we talk about TCU? Were you still, or not TCU, Kansas State? Were you still on for that? I can't even remember how many we haven't talked about.
So let me check the schedule.
I can't remember the Kansas State game for sure, but I know Bedlam, no doubt.
So we talked that Thursday, so it would have been the 5th, I guess, my last show. So we talked a little bit about Kansas State. So we've had 3 games.
Wow.
We've had 3 games. It's been – because I went into the hospital the 12th. I stopped doing radio on the 5th, and it's the 30th. So it's almost been an entire month.
Well, that's pretty crazy. I didn't even realize that. But
absolutely.
So with everything that's gone on with Oklahoma State football, you know, we get a chance to see a pretty wild victory mm-hmm. against Texas Tech this weekend. And, you know, it was a must win. Obviously, they all are at this point for Oklahoma State. If they want to have any shot at the Big 12 title game, of course, they need some help as well. West Virginia in particular with Oklahoma. Iowa State basically punched their ticket with the win over Texas this weekend. And, man, what a story they've been this year. Really overall. So with that, you know, and then we come into this game at Texas Tech and find out right before, and it's kind of been that way the last few games if you think about it, before game time, okay, who's going to be out with injury? I mean, that's just really how it has been.
Absolutely.
For Oklahoma State football. And that's a bummer. Like, you don't want that to be the case, and it's understandable at this point in the season how that can happen. You know, you're getting late in the season and injuries occur, no doubt. But with the players that they, you know, they've occurred with, that's been the issue. So you come into this one knowing, okay, before the game starts, Chuba's going to be out. I remember even watching the College Game Day Kirk Herbstreit is sitting there on College Game Day. He's like, well, I've got some news. Maybe there's a little bit of a rumor, and it's possible that Chuba Hubbard will not be playing because of COVID. And I'm thinking, well, okay, that's, I guess, you know, we hadn't heard anything about that this week. Then we find out, no, it's still a leg injury, all that. LD was suited up and didn't go. So you get the idea, well, now it's who's next up, and it's Dez Jackson. And it's like, okay, well, we've seen just a little tiny bit of him this year. And, you know, there's been times where occasionally on a couple runs he's had, it's like, oh, that's a pretty athletic play, look good. But my goodness, this dude comes out, and you talk about handling the work of two guys. That's what he did. He picked up for LD and Chuba in this game and then handled 36 carries. No running back handles 36 carries at really any level anymore. That's nuts. That's a lot of work. That is a lot of work. And, you know, he turned it into such a good performance. I mean, it was incredible. I think that he's definitely the first main takeaway I have from that game just because of how quickly he started out and then never really looked back. He had the turnover, but the way he was able to bounce back was big time. And I think what it did, Zach, was it kind of gave people a bit more confidence in the running game in the future for Oklahoma State, because we know that, you know, Chuba's going to be gone, and it was a chance for Desmond to really show what he has. And this was with a banged up offensive line. I mean, that's the important part. And then they played okay. They played better, and that was with no Tevin Jenkins. But man, I mean, I this has been a long time since I've seen a workload like this and seen it so effective as well. And I know Desmond turned the heads of a lot of people. He really got my attention in this one.
Dez came into that game with, let's see, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 carries for 135 yards.
That's wild.
He goes out and he posts 36 carries for 235 yards, three touchdowns, two receptions for 23 yards. There were two of the best performances we've seen all year long in that ballgame. Obviously, Dez Jackson. Dez Jackson put up the best running performance of any running back this year. And I know you can go back to the early games when LD really broke out, and those were impressive because we have not seen that from LD. LD is a different running back this year. He's transformed himself mentally. He's transformed himself physically. LD earned his snaps this year. There's no doubt. Dez Jackson earned a starting spot going into next year. Now, listening to Gundy today, you know, Chuba and LD, they're going to be reevaluated today. They're going to try to go tomorrow. I don't know what we're looking at. And Gundy said that going into this weekend that Dez is the starter. And so I'm not worried about the future, because what we saw from Dez Jackson was a guy that was that had so much to prove, because we didn't know anything about him. You know, coming out of I think he went to Hutch, if memory serves me correct. I have his bio right here. I think so. Hutch, yeah, played at Hutch. No one knew anything about him. You know, I mean, you look at what he did that last year in 2018, and he rushed for over 1,200 yards, 13 touchdowns, 163 carries. But JUCO is such a different animal than Division I, so you don't know what he's going to do. You know, he took the year to redshirt, played a little bit towards the end of the year, got in the game a little bit against Texas A&M, and I think Baylor. But what Dez Jackson did is he went out there and secured a starting job for next year. Unless Dominic Richardson just blows up in the offseason and throughout the spring, which is possible because, you know, Richardson is really good as well. But yeah, man, I think you hit it right on the head. Dez Jackson calmed a lot of fears after that ball game.
Yeah, because it was even coming into this year, I thought to myself, you know, what is Oklahoma State going to do a running back when they lose the production that Chuba Hubbard brings? And then, of course, this season comes along and he's nowhere near what he used to be, at least last year. And Dez really came in and made a name for himself. I think it's a fan favorite too.
I think you hit it right on the head as well. I think you were spot on. The offensive line on Saturday was better than it has been in a while. They're still banged up. You know, Tevin didn't play. We find out today that he's gonna skip out the last two games of the year, and then the bowl game. He's gonna be declared for the NFL draft. Good for him. Get healthy. Go get your money. But you look at what Dez Jackson did with a patched up, banged up offensive line. The offensive line, you look at the guys, and there is a lot of talent there, but there's a lot of youth and a lot of inexperience. And so you look at what he did on Saturday with an offensive line that's being held together with bubble gum and rubber bands, and you take a look at that offensive line, they're only going to lose a few pieces. Now, granted, you're losing a center who has started two seasons in a row. You're going to lose a right tackle who is a top three tackle in the country. That's a big, big loss.
Yeah.
You lose a left tackle, left guard, right guard, and Josh Seals, who has really, really held that line together at points. So, I mean, you're losing some pretty good anchors. But you look at the guys that are coming up behind him. You look at the guys that are playing this year, Preston Wilson, Hunter Woodard, Jake Springfield, you know, Eli Russ. Oklahoma State does not get offensive linemen as freshmen that are physically ready to go their first year, and that's Eli Russ. He just needs the experience and a little bit of, you know, D1 banging around with the defensive line. But Eli Russ, I fully expect him to play next year. So you look at what the offensive line could be next year with the promise of what Dez Jackson showed on Saturday. I tell you, man, the running game, if Spencer Sanders can figure it out and he can quit turning the ball over, yeah, and he can mature a little bit, that offense is going to be so dangerous.
Yeah, and if you look at an Oklahoma State team on offense, they have – a lot of teams are this way, but – Oklahoma State especially, because they don't have the passing game that can necessarily make up for it. They have to have a run game to have balance. You just
absolutely
do. And this team, no doubt, has to be able to have that guy. And guess what? If they can put 36 carries on a guy like Dez Jackson, they're completely fine with that, because it takes a lot of pressure off a guy like Spencer Sanders, who, I'm sorry, but this season has – since he's come back, he also has not been the same. I mean, he just hasn't.
No, absolutely. But, go back to last year. I mean, you look at what – you know, you scroll through. You know, someone asked Gundy today about it, and maybe Barry Trammell or something. You don't see guys carrying the ball more than 20, 22, 23 times. This is going back to the 80s, and I think Gundy was pretty spot on. Running backs nowadays are not conditioned. They are not trained to carry the ball more than 20,
right,
25 times. But you look at, you know, you look at what Chuba did last year. So you go back, and of course the website's going slow. Here we go. So you look at what he did last year. Chuba had, against Texas, 37 carries. Texas Tech, 34. Baylor, 32. So they, I mean, but you look at what the offense was last year. They, like you said, they didn't have a passing game. Chuba was physically able to handle carrying the ball 25, 26, 30, 35, 36 times and still be productive, because they didn't have that passing game. And this year, like you said, they still don't have that passing game. And it's not necessarily on Spencer Sanders, because he can't pass. He overthrows a lot, you know, and he rushes things and he throws the ball away. But he's a run first quarterback.
Yeah.
No matter what way you slice it, Spencer is going to run that ball. He's looking to run the ball first. I think even if they call up a pass play, Spencer, if he had his choice, sorry, KC, I didn't see an open receiver. I had to take it around the end. Dez Jackson, Robert talked to him after the game, and we talked to him after the game. And someone asked him, you know, that's a lot of carries, you know, and he's like, I feel fine. I didn't even know I had that many carries. I could have carried the ball more. You know, if he can handle next year, he can handle that amount of carries, I think you're going to see it happen.
Well,
I honestly think you're going to see it happen.
The dude found out, you know, early in the week, and he even said once he knew that, there was this different mode that he went into.
Absolutely.
And I think that was an excellent, excellent week of practice. It was excellent preparation, and it showed on game day. I mean, he was ready to go. There was not one time where he looked like, when he carried that ball or when he had a touch, that he looked like, you know, not confident or unable to make a play. Like, every single time he touched the ball, it was confidence like we haven't seen this year, and he thought he was going to the house every time. I mean, it really was that type of confidence. And you bring up a good point, and Gundy did too when he talked about it. You know, if you look at anywhere in football, and a lot of the talk now is about running backs, and even Chuba coming in this year was a good example. Mm-hmm. Well, we don't want to give too much of a workload to these guys because you do want them to be able to be used again and again and again later on in the season. And if Chuba had taken on that same workload from last year and say he would have been fully healthy, he wouldn't have been – honestly, the NFL wouldn't have liked that, and he wouldn't have liked that. I mean, if you move on to the next level. If you look in the NFL – guys that get 30 touches in a game, that's considered a huge workload. And so that's I think that's where the value and the most impressive part of what Dez did absolutely lies with me as well, is what he was able to do with that work. And you said it, you know, the production value that came from it too. Because a lot of, you know, if a guy has 36 carries in a game, but he's only averaging a couple yards a carry, well, that doesn't really matter. But when a guy has 36 carries in a game, he turns into 3 touchdowns. Oh, and by the way, could have had a fourth, but slid down, you know, to kind of end out the game, which
you mean confuse everybody?
Right. Which personally, I was hoping I'd just go straight in. I'd be like, you know, just take that. I mean, I guess I get it a little bit there, but take it in, man. That's number 4. And it's Texas Tech. Who cares? Just go in there, you know. So it was one of those things for me. But he played really, really well. He did a great job of making sure that everybody understood that the future's okay. At least we think it is for now. And, you know, we're going to get into more when we come back here about Chuba and about Tevin, because, yes, he did announce today he's done with college football, which I'll kind of give you a warning here before that I'm with you. I'm fine with that. It absolutely makes sense to me. We're going to hit on that a little bit more, too. Also, when we come back, OSU basketball 2-0 on the season. It was a pretty good week and weekend overall for Oklahoma State. And they play tomorrow in the biggest game of the year so far, absolutely, against Marquette. So that'll be a fun one, and that'll be tipping off tomorrow, I believe, 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock on FS1. You can check that one out. So when we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, we'll get into all that. And now we're number 2. Levi Pekapaw is going to join. We got buy or sell coming up, and talk about the NFL. Crazy week. Weekend in the NFL. We had Thanksgiving games, it seems like forever ago as well. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster back after this. You can call till your voice is running now, but I can't hear you now. I can't hear you now. I'm somewhere far away where you can't bring me down. So I can't hear you now. I can't hear you now. Yeah. Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster here on this Monday. We're going to look at Oklahoma State football. Big win for them against Texas Tech. As we mentioned, had to happen. These wins got to happen. You know, they got to get TCU, which we now know 11 a.m. kickoff again. Boo. I'm saying that. I'm not a fan of 11 a.m. kickoffs. Here we go again, though, on Saturday. And then.
Oh, I love them.
I knew you were going to say that.
But I love them because I cover them.
That's the thing.
So you can wake up, you can have a little breakfast, you can watch a little bit of game day, you cover the game, you're done by 4, and then you have the rest of the day to do whatever you want. It's awesome.
That part is good. But as you know, my day starts at 6 a.m.
I tell you, those are the worst.
It's 6 a.m. Saturday.
Those are so awful.
And we did one this past weekend. So it's, you know, back-to-back, it's like, all right, here we go. But other than that, you know, I guess I can get with it. I'm trying to ignore that Oklahoma just got another night game, but
You're excited about Baylor next week?
I really am.
That's going to be interesting.
Yeah,
6 p.m. in Waco is always an interesting go around for Oklahoma State.
Yeah, no, it is. I just think that there's so much into these last two games. You know, I mean, and they have really, really have to have some help. But and that's what kind of brings me to what I want to talk about next with Tevin, because we find out today that he officially is opting out. It's kind of way to put it, you know, and it's something that, you know, he was talking about with Mike Gundy already. You heard Gundy today basically said that's where he thought Tevin was headed, and he knew at that time that's where he was headed. He was waiting for the official announcement. Tevin made that official on Twitter. But here's the thing, and I've seen people, you know, that have been, you know, why could you do this? You know, why would you do this at this point? And it doesn't make sense, blah, blah. No. This makes perfect sense.
Yes,
you know, Tevin Jenkins is about to go make a lot of money. He is about to go make a lot of money in the NFL. and I'm all for it at this point as well. And would it be different if Oklahoma State had a guaranteed spot in the Big 12 championship? Or
I still don't think so.
That's what I was going to say. I don't either. And I think the injury definitely, you know, pushed that forward. Mm-hmm. It absolutely did accelerate that, dealing with the back injury. And, look, I'm going to guess that he had an agent lined up, and that was the advice he was getting. And I understand it. I do. And that's why, at the same time, I thought to myself when this happened, and I even thought earlier this year, when we knew Chuba and Tylan were coming back, and now I could say, you know, if Tylan were to come out and say, look, I'm done because I'm preparing for the NFL, I wouldn't blame him for a second either. But at this point, he's going for that Biletnikoff again, and he's really going to be, I think, the front runner, and he's playing, you know, crazy good, and maybe still has a little bit to play for here. But, you know, Chuba has even more. If he were to come back at this point in the season, if Oklahoma State were where they were, and Chuba comes at this situation and says, look, I'm not going to play anymore, I'm going to get ready for the draft, it's another person I wouldn't blame. But at this point, he probably does have a little bit to prove all of a sudden, because it hasn't been the year that he wanted. So with guys that are for sure going to get into the league at some point here, and a talent like Tylan Wallace, people have to realize that college football for these guys, it's all great and fun, but at some point here, when they realize how much money, first of all, is on the line, where they want to take their career is on the line, you got to take advantage while the sun's still shining here. And that's why, you know, Tylan is the premier example, because he is going to be on an NFL team soon, and I think he's going to make a difference on an NFL team soon, and a lot of money will await him down the line. And a lot of guys we've seen in the bowl games before. They won't play in the bowl games because they're going to get ready for the draft. We talked about it with COVID this year, why a lot of players, honestly, especially in the Big Ten and Pac-12, it would have made sense for the best players there, like Justin Fields even, to go ahead and just call it a season. And I completely get that. So that's what people have to understand. It's not giving up on your team. It's not turning your back on your teammates. If there's no clear opportunity to get to a championship game or a college football playoff, put yourself in that situation. What would you do? You'd go to the league. It would go to the league in a heartbeat. There's some people that would say, it's giving up and it's not being a true brother. Look, you got to look past that. These guys are human beings and they have personal goals and aspirations. And guys like Tylan and Tevin have millions of dollars on the line. So they're going to make this decision. So I understand it and I agree with it for Tevin for sure.
You've got a handful to two handfuls of players that are going to make money in the NFL, legit money in the NFL. Maybe not this year. You know, you got, I think, maybe a handful of guys that are going to make money. Obviously, mm-hmm. Rodarius Williams has made himself a very, very rich man this season. Tevin has real, and he was really good last year, but Tevin's turned it around mentally, and Tevin has made himself a very, very rich man. Chuba's going to make a lot of money. Tylan's going to make an obscene amount of money. I don't blame Tevin, because from a fan standpoint, yes, it sucks. It's awful. You're losing your starting right tackle. Pro Football Focus ranks him as the number three tackle in the country. Most likely, if he can get healthy and has a decent combine, most likely going to be a first round, maybe early second round type of draft pick. Tevin gets hurt in Bedlam in the first quarter, can't go. You know, I don't blame him, because if he comes back and he gets injured again, you know, or he blows out a knee, you're looking at fourth, fifth, sixth round.
Well, and then maybe not even that. And then Zach, a back injury is no joke.
I hurt my back working at Lowe's, man. It puts you on your butt.
It does. It's, and for an offensive lineman, guess what? It's pretty important. So
absolutely,
you have to, like I said, this is him taking advantage of a situation.
I think you were spot on. You look at Chuba. Yeah. I think Chuba has a lot to prove. I think that, you know, Gundy was asked today if what he did last season would be enough to carry him over. Mm-hmm. And I think, I think last year it carries a lot of weight. I think it carries a lot of merit. But if I'm the NFL, and I'm not trying to stir anything up, but if I'm the NFL, I look back at what happened over the summer. I look at you know the social media. I look at what happened with Gundy. I look at not having a spring. I look at not really having a summer. I look at, you know, him and Amen pulling the team together and having a team meeting. And then all of a sudden, you look at what Chuba's done this year, you know, and okay, Chuba's been a little banged up. Chuba's season high was 145 yards. Do you know who that was against? That was against Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
His season high in rushing touchdowns, 2. Do you know who that was against?
Ugh.
Kansas.
Yeah.
His longest rush of the year, go back to last year. You look at 2019 stats, and of course, it chooses to load slowly. But you look at what he's done this year, you know, a season high of a long rush was 32 yards, and that was against Iowa State. You go back to last year, season high rushing yards, 296 against Kansas State. Longest rush last year, 92 against TCU. Rushing touchdowns, 3, and it's against Texas Tech, but you go through the year, he had 3 against Oregon State, he had 3 against Tulsa, he had 3 against Texas Tech. You know, he had 2 several times. Reception yards, that's whatever, 88 yards. But this year, you know, but you go back, like, he had 21 rushing touchdowns, he had 2,094 yards, and he had 328 carries. You come to 2020, he has, wow, that's really, he has 5 rushing touchdowns.
Yeah, that's 5. That's just an unbelievable drop off. And you know
5
what?
5 rushing touchdowns, 625 yards,
wow,
and 133 carries. If I'm the NFL, I look at what happened over the summer, and I'm trying to fit, and I look at him coming back,
yeah,
and I'm looking at the no spring and no summer, and I'm looking at, okay, well, is this performance, I know he's a little banged up, but is this okay, well, he wasn't as prepared, and then you had the mental aspect with the coaching staff, like, or is this, you know, is there some regret of him coming back, or is this him dropping off? Because not many people rush for over 2,000 yards, you know, and I agreed with him coming back. I thought he should come back, because you go back to the year before, his body of work was very, very small. If he puts up, even if he puts up 1,400 yards this year, I mean, that's still really, really good. I don't know if last year is enough to carry him. So Chuba, he's got a little bit to prove. And you know, let's say worst comes to worst, and the chips don't fall in Oklahoma State's direction, you know, and they don't make the Big 12 championship. Then you look at Tylan, and you look at Chuba, you look at Rodarius. Do those guys, and maybe there might be a few others that are going to try to take their chances. If I'm those three guys, I seriously, seriously, seriously consider whether or not I'm going to play in the bowl game.
Because no, absolutely.
I think that I with Chuba and Tylan and Rodarius, with the Big 12 championship still somewhat on the table, I think you see those three guys play. You know, if they're healthy and they're able to go, I think you're going to see those guys play against TCU, and I think you're going to see those guys play against Baylor, because if OU loses a game, you know, then Oklahoma State has a way to get back in. But if, you know, God forbid they drop one of those games, or, you know, Oklahoma, let's say they win out and Oklahoma wins out and Iowa State wins out, and it's, you know, then they're not getting in. If I'm those three guys, I'm like, I don't know if I want to go to the Alamo Bowl or the Heart of Dallas Bowl or wherever. I don't even know what they would go to, the Camping World Bowl or whatever. I would seriously, I'm like, I don't know if I want to do that. I think I'm going to set out, because I don't want to risk it. And it's not, like you said, it's not abandoning your teammates.
No.
It's not, well, you're not being a man, you know, you're abandoning your brothers. This isn't high school.
No, it's a business.
You know, there's 5% of this team has a chance to make legitimate, serious, serious money. And this year is kind of an exception for me anyway. You know, if you don't drop that, if you don't get blown out by OU, you know, and you don't drop the ball against Texas, and you still control your own destiny getting into the Big 12 championship, then maybe that conversation can be had of, well, maybe you're being a little bit selfish, you know, maybe you should stick it out. Maybe you should come back. But if that's off the table, I'm not going to fault Rodarius or Chuba or Tylen or whoever else is going to say, you know what, I'm hearing from people. Maybe I'm going to try my hand in the NFL and go out there and break an ankle or tear an ACL or get a severe concussion or what have you. You know, I'm looking at, well, I could be a first 3-4 round draft pick kind of a guy and make a couple million bucks.
Zach, two things that Chuba and the NFL wanted to see out of him and improve this year. One was pass catching.
Absolutely.
You can't go to the NFL without being able to catch the ball out of the backfield.
He has 52 receiving yards.
Yeah. That was something that needed, and he worked on this offseason. That was something that needed to happen this year on a more consistent level. Two was pass protection. He needed to be a better pass blocker. And that wasn't the case. See, we didn't see a lot of that even when he was out there. So those were two things he needed to improve on, didn't get a chance to. And let me tell you what the issue is now in the NFL, for instance, for a guy like Chuba. Because last year was awesome, no doubt. And it got a lot of people excited. Okay, if he goes to the next level, he could be the next big thing. Who knows? If he's going to continue to run like that and can handle a workload like that, that's great. But this year again, okay, we are seeing the perfect example. Jacksonville Jaguars running back James Robinson, undrafted free agent out of Illinois State. Undrafted free agent. And he is not very many yards away from beating out Philip Lindsay from 2018 in the record of 1,278 yards from scrimmage. Okay? Philip Lindsay, undrafted free agent.
Yep.
Last year in the Super Bowl, Damian Williams and Raheem Mostert in the Super Bowl on two different teams playing a big part in the Super Bowl, both undrafted free agents. Right now, the NFL has been able to find gym after gym after gym and not have to waste a really high pick on a running back.
Or money.
Or money. That's exactly right. And we've seen that when they pay a lot of money to running backs, which if anyone knows me, they know that I think there are a few backs that deserve a big-time payday. Very few, but there are. And we've seen at times that doesn't pay off. Ezekiel Elliott is a perfect example of that this year. So at that position in the NFL now, it has become interchangeable. If you get guys like James Robinson this year, who's also doing this, by the way, behind no offensive line in Jacksonville, you get Philip Lindsay, who kind of did the same thing, and you get those two guys I mentioned in the Super Bowl. It goes on and on with guys that are being found because just because they don't get drafted doesn't mean they're not good backs. And that's kind of been the case for these last few years, and it hasn't helped a guy like Chuba Hubbard because teams that will pass on him that might not even take a second look at him for things that have happened this year for the lack of production and all this, they know that that's okay because if they don't get their hands on him, guess what? There's plenty of backs that might not even be drafted that have a real shot at making something happen with this team. So that has not helped a guy like Chuba Hubbard. This situation,
if
he needed
Mike
to come
Gundy,
back.
And if I'm Mike Gundy and Waz and even Chuba, if I'm Gundy and Waz, I sit down with Chuba and I seriously consider, you look at the performance that Dez had last week. I talked to Chuba and I don't know if you play him this week because he has been, and it's not even production wise. It's the fact that he's been so banged up all year long, and I think that'll play a big part. You know, obviously the production's not there on any on touchdowns, carries, rushing yards, receptions. The production just has not been there. If I'm the NFL, I do put a lot of stock into the fact that he's been banged up virtually the entire year. You know, towards the beginning of the year, you know, he was okay. Like the first 4 weeks, you know, he put up 93, 101, 145, 139. And then he has 25 carries for 72 yards against Texas. He has 6 carries for 31 yards against Kansas State. He has 8 carries for 44 yards against Oklahoma. Doesn't even play last week. If I'm Chuba and Waz and Gundy, I'm sitting down and I'm having that conversation of, listen, I know you need production. I know you need tape. I know you need to prove it. but we're thinking about sitting you for another week. What are your thoughts on that? Because we need to get you healthy. And if I'm Chuba, I take it, because he has to get healthy. Because if he goes out there on Saturday with you know, even if he's 80% on that leg, you know, that I don't know if you want to risk it.
No, I completely agree.
Because then you combine that with the production.
Yeah.
And it makes it look even worse to the NFL.
Yeah, no, it's just been, he has now found himself in a rock and a hard place situation.
Absolutely.
This is not how this season was supposed to play out for Chuba Hubbard, and I agree. Injuries have a big part to play into it, as they have.
Well,
and
then your third string, and then your third string back goes out,
exactly,
and rushes for over 230
yeah,
yards.
Yeah, you can't catch a break. You can't catch a break at this point if you're Chuba. So, and look, it's not an issue for Oklahoma State. I mean, let's be honest. And you know what? They've kind of got into a situation where all of a sudden their running backs have now been interchangeable. And it's crazy, but it has been that way for teams in the NFL. Mm. We're seeing it now in college. Sometimes all these guys need is a little bit of a chance, and guys like Dez Jackson show they have what it takes to get it done. When we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, we're going to get buy or sell in pretty quickly here at the end of the hour. An hour number two, Levi Peckinpah is going to join. We'll get into some OSU basketball, 2-0 on the season, some NFL, all coming up still on the Afternoon Sports Drive here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Welcome back to the Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancast. You ready to wrap up hour number one here on the program? And before we do, it's been a while since Zach's been able to do this. I know he's chomping at the bit, so let's get to it.
Are you buying?
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Or are you selling?
You'll pick up the phone and you'll sell, sell, sell.
This is Buy or Sell on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Make money, money, make money.
Buy or Sell, Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. All right, Zach, since it's been a while, I'm going to give you the honors of cracking the egg today.
Oh, what a gentleman. Buy or sell, Oklahoma State beats TCU and Baylor to finish the season with only two losses.
Oh, man. You know what? I am encouraged by what I saw, and I know we'll get more into Oklahoma State as we go through the week in terms of what they did Saturday, but I was encouraged by the offense for the most part. I know there were times still where it was like they left a little bit on the table. You don't want to see the interception from Spencer again. I mean, you know, at that point, it's like, it was a bad one. It was a bad interception. And you're tired of seeing that. I completely get it. But overall, you know, you talked, Mike Gundy mentioned, I think last week or week before, whatever it was, that he wants to see a complete well-rounded game, you know, from the special teams, defense, offense. And I thought for the most part we did see that, because I know the defense gave a lot of points, but you saw, you know, what they were able to do and have an impact, and it kind of was with the special teams towards the end of that game when you got the, you know, onside kick return for a touchdown. You got the pick six. They stepped up, and they made their plays when they needed to at the end. So I thought this was about as close of a well-rounded type win as we've seen all season long. So with that being said, I'm encouraged by where they're going. I'm encouraged by Dez Jackson. If that means, you know, the Chuba and LD, if they're not good to go for these last two games, I think we're okay. The running back spot, Tylan is continuing to play out of his mind. And guess what the best thing was? Spencer Sanders got other receivers involved. He finally targeted a bunch of different guys and spread the wealth around a little bit. And what do you know? It absolutely helped him. So I'm going to buy it. With these two opponents, I think TCU is beatable. And I think Baylor is certainly beatable at this point in the season. So, and then with the fact you throw in the extra that Oklahoma State absolutely has to win these games to even give them themselves even a slight chance of getting into the Big 12 title game, I think they find a way to pull it out. And maybe asking for a lot here to round out the season, but I'm going to buy it right now and say they get it done.
Absolutely. You eliminate 3 to 4 plays on defense, because Tech scored, what, 21 points? 28 points on big plays. You eliminate 3 to 4 plays on defense, and Oklahoma State absolutely beats the brakes off of Texas Tech.
Yeah, I agree.
First special teams touchdown since 2014 when Tyreek Hill returned a punt against Oklahoma.
That's crazy.
Yeah, you have multiple fumble recoveries. You got a defensive touchdown from Trey Sterling, who absolutely got snubbed on Defensive Player of the Week this week in Big 12. TCU's 4-4, Baylor's 2-5. Like you said, Oklahoma State absolutely has to win these two games. that there's no hope of college football playoff. No hope. And
that's for the Big 12 as a whole as well.
Yeah, the way they're going right now mentally. They beat both TCU and Baylor.
Yeah, I like that. I'm going to stick with Oklahoma State football for my first one. We kind of hit on it before the break, but you buy or sell that Chuba Hubbard plays another game for Oklahoma State this
year? I'll buy it just because he has to. You know, with injury, with it, now if he's more banged up than we realize, maybe not. But I, you know, with Gundy saying that both him and LD are going to try to practice on Tuesday, Chuba has to play. He has to play. Now, if they pull what has been prevalent the past two or three years and they lose to TCU or they lose to Baylor, then no. Like, if they you know, knock on wood, if they lose to TCU on Saturday, Chuba won't play. I think Chuba's done.
Yeah.
And I think there's a chance you could have more guys. I'm not sure. Going to say who, but I think – Chuba wouldn't be the only one.
Yeah, if this was if we were at this point, and Oklahoma State had, let's say they lost Texas Tech and they had three losses, we'd be seeing some more guys besides Devin.
Oh, today, tomorrow.
Yeah.
I like I said, I'm buying OSU beating TCU Baylor. So with that, yes, Chuba plays more.
Yeah, I'm gonna buy that he plays again, and a lot of it as well as if he is healthy and good. I mean, at least good enough to go, because what we talked about, he still needs to show a little bit. You know, this doesn't need to be a season ended on. Last we saw was what he managed to do against Oklahoma, which wasn't much, and then he didn't even play against Texas Tech. You don't want that to be the end of Chuba's career. I don't think it's going to be, even if it means he's on a snap count or whatever. I think he's going to play again, but he needs, I mean, for his own good, for the next level.
Absolutely.
He needs a little bit. What else you got for me?
Buy or sell, Mike Boynton and company, along with Cade Cunningham, of course, go undefeated in non-conference play. You've got four games left. Marquette's going to be tough. You go up to Milwaukee. They're 2-0. Marquette, as of right now, 4.5-point favorites. Then you get 0-4 Oakland at home. You get 1-1 Oral Roberts at home. And, of course, Wichita State has yet to play a game, but you wrap up non-conference play with them on the 12th if that game gets played. So 3-4 games remaining. Does Oklahoma State go undefeated in non-conference?
Sorry, OSU fans, please don't hate me, but I'm going to sell, because I think that this game tomorrow with Marquette is absolutely going to be a really, really tough matchup. Marquette, as you said, 4-point favorites. You know, they come in, and I think that they're catching Oklahoma State, you know, obviously winning those first two games. But if we see them do anything like they tried to pull against UTA in the first game of the season, which that first half was not good. I mean, let's be honest. It was bad. I thought they looked way better against Texas Southern. It all completely rounded out, and it looked like the team we were expecting a little bit there. So, but this is a different level with Marquette. I think they find a way to beat Oklahoma State here, but I'll tell you this at the same time. This is going to be an excellent, excellent learning opportunity, because if Oklahoma State gets beat early right here, they can beat off of this, and I think the rest of the way through, wipe through that non-conference schedule. And if you can win the rest of those games, and hey, if you win Marquette, that's even better. If you could win out your non-conference games and get into the Big 12 conference play on a win streak with this team, that's when you start saying watch out. I think if they were to manage to also beat Marquette tomorrow, you'd start seeing more consideration to possibly even push them up towards the top 25, because I think they have that talent and they're that good, and we saw that on display against Texas Southern. But this is a really young team. They still have to figure a few things out. I think Marquette's going to be just a little bit too much to handle.
Yeah, Andy Katz included Oklahoma State in his top 36 or whatever it is, the NCAA rankings, top 36. I think they were 32, 33 or something like that. The game against Texas Southern was a huge game. Texas Southern's a really good team. They have a ton of Division One, Power Five transfers, if you will, Power Five, whatever. Really, really talented team. They beat them by 20. UTA was the perfect start. You go down on the road. The first road game of the year, the first game of the year with the guys that never played college basketball before. Incredibly difficult, and they figure out a way to win, and they compound on that, and they figure things out more, and they beat a really salty team that nearly beat Washington, or was it Washington State? Marquette, like you said, is a much, much different animal.
Yeah.
But Marquette, if you look at who they've played, Marquette hasn't really played anybody. They beat a Arkansas Pine Bluff team at home, I think. Not that impressive of a win. And then they beat an Eastern Illinois team at home by 25. I'm really, really torn here because Cade Cunningham has really started to kind of come into his own. Mm-hmm. I know it's only been two games. Rondell Walker had a huge game. But I'm going to sell, but it's going to be a win because I think they're going to play Marquette really close.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know if they have enough to get past Marquette just because they're so young. I would love to eat my words. So if anyone in the basketball program or Tom Dorado or whoever, if anyone's listening and you're going to report back to Boynton, tell them I would love to eat my words because this Oklahoma State team, I think they have a chance to beat Marquette. But I don't know if they get past them. I think it'll be really close, but they lose, which for this young team and an experienced team is going to be a win.
Yeah.
But then I do think they get the next three.
Yeah,
I think they go 3-1 to finish.
That's what I completely agree, and I hope I'm 1,000% wrong with you, no doubt.
Absolutely.
Last thing real quick, my last one for you. Tonight we have Seahawks-Eagles Monday Night Football. Russell Wilson, buy or sell, he goes over 300 yards passing tonight.
Man, it's tough because you look at what he's done this year. He's had one, two, three. He's only had four games of going over 300 yards this year.
Mm-hmm.
And they were against the Bills, the Cardinals, the Dolphins, and the Falcons. He got close against the Patriots, which I'm not impressed with because the Patriots are awful.
Woo.
Only 217 against the Vikings, 197 against the Cardinals the second time, less than 250 against the Rams, barely over 260 against the 49ers. Now, with that being said, the Eagles are awful.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to sell. Okay. I don't think it happens.
I'm going to buy because it's been two games since he's done that, like you said, and he basically had a bye week since they hadn't played since that last Thursday with the Cardinals, mm-hmm. And he gets this extended day here. I think he has a huge game. The Eagles are – they've been somewhat okay against the pass game at times defensively this year, but this is Russell Wilson, and you give him a rest, to give him a break like this, no, he's going to have a really, really good game. I'm going to buy that. I'll give him 350 or so yards.
I'm buying
tonight.
Chris Carson, though.
Ooh, he's back. Yeah, he's good to go. Yeah, it's been a while since he's been able to play.
I'm buying Chris Carson. I'm thinking like 150 and two touchdowns.
Whoa. All right, hey, I'm all 40, for it.
45, at least 45 receiving yards.
Ooh, okay, I like it.
Yeah.
I like the prediction. Yeah, let's go Chris Carson. There's buy or sell on the afternoon sports drive. When we come back in hour number two, Levi Peckinpah is going to hop on. We got a lot more to get into after this. I don't want to wait for our life to be over. You have me. Would you take it how you left me? This is giving pain. Take your time. Take me under. I want it. Could you show me what I'm missing? In the plate. Welcome back to the afternoon sports drive. It's hour number two. Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Levi Peckinpah is in the house. Levi, what's going on, man?
When the mic on, it's just another day in paradise.
Yeah,
it's just been constantly working and working. It's weird. After
Bro.
You get done having COVID, it's like, all right, back into the system you go.
You put in that work.
Oh, yeah, we put in that work. And I told you it was within 8 days, 34 hours. It was, and it was two altogether for game days. It was 8 hours and 9 hours on the two game days that I
with Zach and I not in studio, you were holding it down.
Oh yeah, we were putting in that work, and just like my man ASAP Ferg would say, put in work.
think we lost Zach there for a second.
That's what happens with the tie line sometimes.
I know it's bothersome at times, but no, he's
I'm sorry.
There he is.
Oh, wait.
He's going to connect here in a second. But when you brought up the ASAP Ferg, that's the bump that we need to get on there for the next one. I like that idea before you even come in.
Yeah, I was thinking during this like little Christmas time that we'll have, because I'll be in and out of studio, I'm literally thinking I'm going to like re-jazz all the bump music for the student section when it comes back, because we're going to do it at the beginning of the next semester.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I'm thinking about just re-theming it, and I'm going to run it by Big Boss Man, and I'm thinking about making a new intro, and I've got an idea.
Fresh heat coming up.
Because you know, winter is coming.
Yes, it is. Don't bring up season 8. I'll get mad. Zach's back. I believe.
Zach's back.
Yeah, Zach's back. What's going
on, man? Back.
Yeah, Robert called.
Oh, now I know who to blame. All right,
so
thanks.
Like, and then it put me way behind. So like I had to disconnect two or three times and like reset it. So
sounds
I'm,
about right.
Like,
yep.
So I'm not like 9 or 10 seconds off.
Yeah, we've
now
we've
I think that. I'm just like a second and a half.
No, that's fine.
Yeah, so that way whenever we set something, it's just that. Not like.
Yeah.
Okay.
Completely doable. Hey, let's get into some OSU basketball because as I said, you know that first game against UTA. You were actually running the board, and we were with Tom,
yep.
And we were all watching it live, and you know, Tom was, he was frustrated. he was frustrated with a lot of what happened, and I could understand.
Tom is my anger management translator, so yeah. I was also frustrated.
Well, it was just, I think in part, you know, there was times where you were okay because you expected a little bit. You weren't expecting this super clean, it doesn't matter who you're playing.
No.
You know, you could have Kate Cunningham on the team, a new team like this, trying to gel in the first matchup, you're going to have some sloppy turnovers and things like that. Mm-hmm. But the stuff that we saw occasionally from Cade was something that I even saw when they did the scrimmage and they aired it that one time, or the practice, I should say, mm-hmm. Was that he was a little unaware of defenders around him when he was, you know, trying to isolate and things like that. Mm-hmm. So that's something that, you know, he's got to improve on. But he poured in the points as expected in these first couple of games. That's great to see. And UTA, again, was a learning experience for a lot of these guys. But you know what? They flipped it around to Texas Southern. And as Zach said, he made a good point there before the break. That was a good Texas Southern team. And they didn't look like they should even be in the same building with Oklahoma State. And that's what you want to see early on in the season. I thought that they dominated that game. The second half was never going to be close. You know, they really finally got a chance to pull away. Mm-hmm. And my goodness, we saw performances from Cade. Rondell Walker decided to come out and couldn't miss from three, mm-hmm. off the bench. And then on top of that, you had one of the nastiest throwdowns I've seen in a long time from Matthew Alexander Moncrief. I bet I rewinded that thing 5 times because it was so dirty.
So clean.
He is, and I'll tell you guys this. I said this before the season started. He was going to be my X factor this year. He was going to be the guy because I think he is uber athletic, extremely talented. Mm-hmm. And if that's just a little taste of what we're going to get out of him, oh man, buckle up for this season.
Oh yeah, Matthew.
There's no doubt that Cade Cunningham is the best player on the team. There's no doubt that he was one of the best players and one of the best freshmen in the country. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the best players in the signing class. Matthew Alexander Moncrief is going to end up being the best player in that signing class. And he's going to have the biggest impact at Oklahoma State.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, whenever you look at Matthew Alexander Moncrief and you look at my ESPN thing not muting whenever I thought it was, truly Matthew Alexander Moncrief to me has the highest ceiling. I think Alexander Moncrief is just playing out incredible, and I think he's got so much potential. It's just the thing is right now he's a freshman. He's very raw, but still shows the skills and potential of a really good player under the Mike Boynton system. And I was excited to see Rondell Walker,
yeah.
And man, he balled out. And it's weird because to me it feels like both Rondell Walker and Avery Anderson are fighting for the same spot, which used to be, funny enough, Michael Weather's spot, the man who was on Texas Southern, former Oklahoma State player.
Yeah,
it's the guy who turned into the replacement is fighting for the replacement spot. It's a weird, like, little triangle of fighting for a spot. But I really think that with the skills that Rondell Walker possesses, I think that he could end up taking that almost first, that sixth man off the bench role. I really think Rondell Walker could shine in that. It's the thing of consistency. That's the main thing that you got to worry about with all these guys. With Keelan Boone and how he played in the first game where he had a double-double, he had 4 points, 4 rebounds. It's trying to find consistency with all of these guys and help get them to an even level so that way whenever you go up against some of these big teams like a Marquette coming up, you need to make sure everybody's on each other's level, and that way you kind of know what's going
on. Well, and what we saw in these first couple of games was, I think, something really important, because when you get a player like Cade Cunningham, it can be really easy for everybody else to kind of back off and expect him to do everything.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't the case in these first couple games. In the first game, I thought Keelan Boone was player of the game.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he played really, really well.
That double-double was
Yeah, playing. it was big time. You have Rondell Walker stepping up already. That was fantastic to see. Matthew Alexander Moncrief, you see Ice kind of going into the spot where it makes sense for him right now. He's not going to be the guy that will necessarily pour in a ton of points per game. He doesn't have to do that.
But he's your Swiss Army knife, yes, and he can fill in and do whatever you want. To me, he's playing the perfect Lindy Waters role that Lindy Waters played these past couple years. He is doing nice things. And my whole criticism for Cade Cunningham is just early. Can't truly, he, of course, he's going to go get his buckets, but that can't be the only thing he does, because this was my comparison. If him and Ice work together on the level that we all think they can, they're going to be the best duo, one of the best duos, not only in the Big 12, but in the nation. If things can go wrong, and this, and it's, if it goes very wrong, where it's just, okay, Cade does it all, and everybody else we stop and it's the Cade show, then this could be our version of Trae Young Sooners. This could be our version. But I think by the way it's going to tip, I don't think it's going to be the whole Cade show. I think this is going to be, because you're slowly starting to see it, everybody's getting involved and making sure to kind of throw everything around, and everybody's getting their time and getting their minutes. I truly think that this could be a really good combination, and truly, I think, bring the best out of Isaac Lightly, Cade Cunningham, and this whole team.
Well, I think what's huge is you look at the numbers compared to UTA to Texas Southern. They shot basically 46% from the field against UTA. They shot 28% from three point range.
Yeah, it was terrible.
And this is a team that is full of 3-point shooters, and they shot 52% from the free throw line. You look at what they did against Texas Southern. They shot 46% from the field. They shot 42% from three, and they shot 78% from free throws. I think that's huge. I mean, it's not only did you get the first game jitters out of the way, but everyone was kind of able to settle down, figure out their role, and go out and play a team that nearly beat a difficult Washington State team on the road to start the season. And that's not easy to do. I don't care who you are. This is a salty team. This is a team that's most likely going to end up winning the SWAC if there is one, and making that NCAA tournament. And you know, you look at Cade to start that UTA game. You know, he missed a couple of buckets, but he was dishing it out. You know, he was looking to create for other guys, and I think you saw that in the Texas Southern game. Cade looks to create. You know, you go back to his high school game, that's what he wants. You know, he's a pass first, he's an assist first, he's looking to create. But Cade knows when to turn it on. Cade knows, okay, you know what? We can't get through this zone. You know, the man-to-man's a little bit too tough. We need to settle it down a little bit. I'm going to drive. I'm going to go and get a quick 9, 12 points, because that's something that he can do. And when you get to that point, everyone almost seems like they take a big breath, you know, a deep breath, and just kind of relax a little bit, and then they start to get into it.
Well, and what I like too is Cade, he just looks the part. I mean, he looks like he's been playing college basketball Division I level for 4 years. He's confident, and he's not afraid to take over a game. That's what you want to see as well. But there are a lot of guys that have stepped in early so far in these first couple of games and made a difference. And, absolutely, by the way, how about this? Virginia, Villanova, and Kentucky.
You got to love it.
Oh, man. All
down.
You
got to love it.
And Kansas lost to Gonzaga. By the way, Gonzaga's starting to try to prove me wrong already. I kind of harped on them being the number one team coming in this year because of who they play in the conference. Well, they looked really good so far.
Oh, don't forget.
Well, to be fair, though, this isn't last year's Kansas.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Now, this is a good Kansas team. This is going to be a Kansas team that's going to contend for another Big 12 championship, regular season and conference. Mm-hmm. You know, if there's an NCAA tournament, they're a team that's going to win at least three games. This is a talented team, but this is a really young team. Mm-hmm. This is a really inexperienced team, and it's a team that I think is going to have problems throughout the year. I think you're going to see them lose games that they should not lose. Like I really like Oklahoma State's chances this year against Kansas. Mm-hmm. But plus, you know, Boynton's had an insane amount of success against Kansas in his short career.
Oh, yeah. It's kind of crazy how much success Mike Boynton has had. The team that I will be circling throughout the Big 12, just because I think that if there's any team that's going to be the most lethal, I really think it's West Virginia. And we're going to be able to see that on Wednesday.
Virginia is going to be really good.
West Virginia versus Gonzaga is going to be insane.
That's
going to
be a great game.
Oh, that's going to be fun. 6 o'clock on ESPN. You can bet your bottom dollar. I will be glued to my seat, and I'm going to be hoping and praying that West Virginia beats Gonzaga. The problem is, if that happens, that means West Virginia is shooting up to the top, and that means they truly are the cream of the crop when it comes to the Big 12 this year.
Yeah, that's a good one. And Baylor has already looked dominant. I mean, they haven't really missed a step. So the Big 12, absolutely up there in conversation with the best conference in basketball this season. I think that's fair. And, you know, I'm watching I was watching the Maui Invitational today. I actually looked at the final score. I don't have to check, but Texas, I think, was up. My Tar Heels play later today, and I don't want them to meet Texas in this situation, because Texas is, and speaking of, by the way, Shaka Smart, got to see the picture of his new hairdo. Wow. That's, in case you guys haven't seen. Zach, is that a perm? I mean, what is that?
He should have, that may just be his natural hair.
I don't know what that is.
Shaka Smart should have been growing his hair from day one.
Unbelievable.
Now that is a look.
Oh yeah.
And just so y'all know, sticking with Texas, where I'm gonna switch it up just a little bit. There's a website, the Austonia News or something. They have an exclusive up on Twitter. Urban Meyer's wife said to be eyeing real estate in Austin.
Oh boy.
Nice. I love it.
Oh man, I love it.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
Oh yeah. Oh boy. But going back real quick to Oklahoma State, I think they've got just ahead before they get into Big 12 play. They got a couple really big opponents. Of course, they've got Marquette coming up tomorrow. But then I'm going to be looking forward on December 12th whenever they play Wichita State, because Wichita State always comes with some packed players. They've always got a couple players that'll be going to the NBA draft, and they've got a really good squad usually. So I think both Marquette and Wichita State to kind of top off, and then to cap their non-conference schedule. Those are two really good opponents.
And what's going to be interesting about that Wichita State game is, how are the players going to play without Greg Marshall?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, what's their, you know, are these players,
they might be free.
Are they going to be are they upset that Greg Marshall is gone? Mm-hmm. Are they relieved and excited like Texas Tech, the Texas Tech women's team was when they lost their coach? You know, is this okay, we're no longer going to be yelled at, we're no longer going to be dog cussed, we're not going to have balls thrown at us, we're not going to be punched, we're not, you know, we get to go out and actually play basketball. And I'm not taking anything away from Greg Marshall's coaching abilities.
No.
There is no doubt that the man can recruit. There's no doubt the man can go out and win ball games. Who the hell wins in Wichita? who wants to live in Wichita? No offense to anyone that might be listening from Wichita, but if you're a 17, 18, 19-year-old kid, and the same could be said about Stillwater.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. But if you're an 18 or 19-year-old kid, do you really want to go and live in the middle of the plains of Kansas? I mean, Greg Marshall has done a hell of a job at Wichita State. So I'm curious to see the mindset of this Wichita, because you could either be walking into a bear trap, or you could be walking into a game where, you know, we don't have our coach anymore, and it, you know, you could easily walk to a win.
Good coach, terrible person. When we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, breaking news out of the NFL, as well as our takeaways from Week 12, which is almost in the books. The reason it's not, because we have tonight's game and one more, which is part of the breaking news. So that's all still to come here after this.
Like I'm gonna puke, because my taxes are due. Do my password begin with a one or a two? Been a hell of a ride, but I'm thinking it's time to grow.
Welcome back, Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Levi Peckinpah. So the breaking news in the NFL is that the Ravens-Steelers game that was already postponed, supposed to happen tomorrow night, is now apparently going to happen on Wednesday night.
At what point do you just give the Steelers the win?
Yeah. Goodness. And here's the thing, okay? Because the Ravens-Steelers, when we saw that Lamar Jackson was one of the positive tests, I was telling Levi over the break that when I first saw that news, I was just waiting for the NFL to say, oh, we're going to act like that we can't play this game because of positive tests, but it's really because there's not going to be any Lamar Jackson. It would be the same way if someone like Patrick Mahomes tested positive or Aaron Rodgers, what have you, an elite quarterback couldn't
Did
be in the game.
Did you just admit that Lamar Jackson is top three quarterback in the league?
No, in the eyes of the NFL, that he is, though. That's exactly, yeah. No, I would never admit that.
In the eyes of the player, he's the best.
That's true. That's true. In the eyes of sports media and everybody else and the players, apparently, for the top 100, he's the best, which is completely wrong. So, but with that being said, the reason why this is now an issue is because what the NFL did to Denver. Okay, the NFL decided to – here's the thing. That's first of all that I'm going to go off on this for a second because this is ridiculous.
Go for it.
You had – Jeff Driscoll test positive, right? He was the initial guy. Then you had all the other quarterbacks, which were three more.
Yeah, I was going to say it was Blake Bortles,
Drew Lock, and Brett Rypien.
Yep.
Three more guys on the list, okay? And you tell them that they cannot play in this game, even though they haven't tested positive, you tell them that they can't play because they were around this guy. What I don't understand is, I get the guy to do the contact tracing, I completely understand that. But if a guy tests negative, even if he's been around somebody, why can't he play? I think that you put yourself in a situation right here, like the Denver Broncos, that now all of a sudden, this is a situation that no team has ever had to deal with. I mean, you can have three, four quarterbacks on your team, practice squad guys and whatever, never expect to have to try to find someone as an emergency backup. They had to go to a practice squad wide receiver.
Undrafted.
Yeah, the dude, I mean, he's never played. And he comes out there, he played in college and played in the NFL. He comes out there, and what do you get? One completion in the entire game. You had more interceptions than you did completions in the game. And the NFL, think about what they did, too, with the opponent. They said, you're going to go out there and hand a win to the New Orleans Saints, who, by the way, on the other side, the Bucs are chasing, and they had a pivotal game against the Chiefs. And they're chasing them, and so no matter what they did, the Saints were going to win. And that's going to move them up in the division. They have no shot. So that, to me, right there was ridiculous. The Broncos come out and say, hey, what about our assistant coach? He played quarterback in college. Can we maybe get the game moved to Tuesday? We can give him a day, and we'll put him in. And the NFL denied that request. So with the NFL basically screwing over Denver here, imagine, first of all, if it was a team that actually mattered. Broncos don't matter, not going anywhere this season. Imagine if it was a team that mattered.
Imagine if it was the Seahawks.
That's right. It's exactly right. Anybody that has a team that's winning right now has a chance to playoff spot. That's why when I heard the news with the Ravens, I thought to myself, if they're going to actually do what they did to the Denver Broncos, which was a complete screw job, and then come back and say, well, we got to postpone this Ravens-Steelers game because we just don't think it can happen. No. If you can physically field a team, the NFL yesterday with the Broncos set a precedent and said that if you can physically fill the team, you're going to go out there and play. And I give them credit overall because the NFL has pulled this off. This was not going to be easy. It hasn't been easy, but they've pulled this off and stayed on schedule for the most part. I had to switch it around a few games, but give them credit where it's due, and they've been able to figure it out. But this right here, they moved the game to Wednesday. There's no game on Thursday now. If you have to, put it to Thursday, but you cannot get rid of this football game because it will look like you're trying to favor giving Lamar Jackson more time to get back while at the same time you said Broncos go out there and get killed by the Saints.
I got a question. Since Pittsburgh has actually been truly holding up majority of the time to the COVID, of course, James Conner did reportedly have COVID, so he's out. But since the majority of time they've been keeping up to protocol, should we just give them all of like the sixth and seventh round picks that the NFL's been confiscating to Pittsburgh as some compensation for truly in a lot of situations giving them the sorry end of the stick with the Titans and now
that's right.
With
this has already
Baltimore.
Happened to them. Yeah.
Like here's the thing. Throughout all of this, throughout the terrible things that the NFL's been trying, they've been trying to navigate their waters. The Pittsburgh Steelers have truly gotten screwed over in a lot of situations, which is weird because yet they still stay undefeated. They're just that good of a team that they have still been able to push through all this. Honestly, my whole thought process about it is most likely I assume not only it's definitely more than just Lamar Jackson, Mark Ingram, and J.K. Dobbins. I bet you the main reason is it's probably a couple offensive linemen, and they're scarce on offensive linemen right now. So with those guys out, it's definitely hard. But if it's not offensive linemen and I'm truly just like out of it and it's like a lot of like specialty players like wide receivers and stuff like that, you can get wide receivers off of your practice squad. And at that point, just let Trace McSorley go out there with Justice Hill at running back and take the whooping you were going to get no matter what. Because I think Pittsburgh was going to win this game, and I thought they were going to stay undefeated. But here's the thing. If they're waiting on some of these guys to come back off of COVID protocols, they're going to be with zero practice, and you're basically walking into the lion's den to get chomped up no matter what. It's going to be a bad game for Baltimore. It's definitely going to be a Pittsburgh victory if it happens Wednesday. But, I mean, you're just kind of setting the Baltimore Ravens up for failure, and you're kind of setting the Pittsburgh Steelers to be even more angry with the purpose than what they usually are.
Here's what you have to do. The NFL has to step in and make this consistent. That's my biggest thing, okay? Because it's like you said, if it were running, we've seen this, if it were a running back, if it were wide receivers or whatever, those guys can be replaced. You have practice squad guys, and it doesn't matter how many you put out, you're always going to have an extra. And you can give a guy that played a different position, he can come in and play running back, okay? Mm-hmm. Your tight end can be a running back if he needs to. It's unbelievable, though, when it happens to the quarterback. This is a special situation. Mm-hmm. If a quarterback and every single one of them, you only have a limited number of them, if they can't go, then you either have to cancel the game or allow the Broncos to do what they were trying to do and give them credit for trying to get creative. Uh-huh. They said, we think we have an option that's a coach right now. And why the NFL's like, nah, we're not going to do it. Like, they gave them an opportunity. And think about this, too. This situation with the Broncos absolutely cannot happen in the playoffs.
Oh, yeah.
Cannot happen in the playoffs.
Are you surprised, though, that the NFL is doing this? I mean, we've known for years and years and years that Roger Goodell and the NFL offices have their favorites. Like you said, if you know, knock on wood, if Patrick Mahomes somehow tested positive, it would be the end of the world. You know, well, you know what? We've got an open date here. And we'll call this franchise and we'll see if they want to switch with these two teams, you know, and we'll move this here and we'll move that there and we can play inside and no fans and the refs will be digital. You know what I mean? Like they would try to do every little single thing they could, you know, like with Baltimore, you keep pushing it back. You keep pushing it back. Denver's terrible. Denver is not good. You know, so you lose all the quarterbacks. And all of a sudden, you're running an undrafted, you know, rookie free agent wide receiver that has never seen the field in the NFL, having to go out there and somehow play against NFL defensive players.
That's what I'm saying.
It doesn't surprise me at all.
Well, it's just the NFL has set a really, really dangerous precedent here. I mean, I think
they surprise me.
No, it's because it goes back to me again, all with the issue with the contact tracing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because they have guys out there for this reason, this many ready to go. They have four guys because if one guy does test positive, then what should happen is what I said. If those other guys test negative, they should be good to go. I mean, so having to keep them out for a while like that is also the issue. And I'll tell you guys this. If I am a quarterback in the NFL, okay, if I'm Patrick Mahomes, if I'm Russell Wilson, if I'm Aaron Rodgers, any elite quarterback that's on a team right now that has a chance in the playoffs, which, by the way, seven from each conference do, okay, it's a lot of teams. I'm basically living an isolated life here, okay, with the rules that are doing with contact tracing. All it would take is my backup quarterback to get COVID, and they say, hey, Patrick Mahomes, you were near him. You got to be out for this game. That's like Zach said. Could you imagine? If that were the case, Kansas City right now with one loss comes into a game down the road. They play the Saints in a few weeks.
Mm-hmm.
They come in and they say, well, you were near Chad Henne and he had COVID. You haven't tested positive, but we can't let you play.
Why does this situation, just because it's in the same division, why does this make the Cleveland Browns seem just a little bit more likable? I don't know why.
I don't know. It doesn't for me. So let's go to the phone lines. Call, you're on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
When are these two teams supposed to play their next games?
Well, I think that would be they both have their bye weeks already, right? Yeah, so it's going to be next Sunday. This is going to be this next Sunday. So that's why you have the issue, like I talked about with the Thursday game, is that would be last resort. You could push it over there, and you would have a really, really, really short window. Probably couldn't do a Sunday game right after that. You'd have to go an extra day there too. But that's the thing, is I think that they are backing this up now to Wednesday. And at one point, do they end up using that as an excuse? Well, we run out of days because these teams got to play. If that ends up being the excuse, that's a really bad
look. Well, hey, the good thing for
Pittsburgh has Baltimore, this weekend, and then you look at, or not Baltimore, they have Washington this weekend.
Yeah, good old football team.
And then the Ravens have Dallas on Monday.
Monday, yeah. So they do actually get an extra day.
Yeah.
See, that's the thing. You're not punishing Baltimore that much because they go from Wednesday to Monday.
Yep.
But Pittsburgh's supposed to play like 3 days later. That's ridiculous.
Well, the good thing is they both play Dallas and Washington.
well,
technically, they're not really playing a ball game.
Yeah, I agree with you guys, though. To me, it's like you're punishing Pittsburgh.
Oh, yeah.
I can see it moving one day, but now that's like, no, you know, Baltimore, you got to go play.
Well,
that's what's interesting because Pittsburgh, they're 10-0, but it's not like they're the most talented team in the league. But they're still 10-0. You know, they're still one of the best teams in the league. You would think that the NFL would be doing anything and everything it could to ensure that the only undefeated team in the NFL, the one of their teams that are a shoe-in to make the Super Bowl, that you would think they would do everything they can to make this as seamless and as easy as possible, because high school teams shouldn't play 3 or 4 days apart. The injury rate is ridiculous, let alone the strongest and the biggest and the best football players on the planet. I don't care, you know, what team you are. I don't care if you're 0-9, 0-10. They're still professional football players.
That's why the Pittsburgh Steelers are so pissed about this.
Oh, absolutely.
They dealt with it with Tennessee earlier in the year.
Absolutely.
And had that mess up. And then now it's the Ravens' fault again. For the most part, right? They've got the outbreak going on their team, and no matter what here, the Steelers lose in this situation.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, and think about it. The team they're going up against is Washington football team. They're not known for offense. They're going to be fine on the defensive end. It's mainly, you're going up against the Washington defense. You're going to be going up, it's going to be Pittsburgh with a tired offensive line and an extremely exhausted Big Ben, and you want to minimize all the potential of Big Ben having some kind of re-injury, because think about it. That's what truly ended the season early a couple years ago for Big Ben was injuries. You want to try to keep these guys as healthy as possible because, honestly, this might be one of Big Ben's last years, like true years of being on top.
Rudolph.
Stop it.
Yeah, because I guarantee you guys are right. Denver would, I mean, he's at least an okay quarterback. They would have given anything to have RG3 on the field.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's why they went to the level of same with the coach. And I just don't understand why the NFL couldn't have gone forward with that. I mean, I knew that they wanted to push the game a little bit, which is completely understandable as well. Maybe they're saying, well, it's not fair to the Saints, and why should they? But come on now. If we're really going to be a league that changes with this virus and adapts to it, which I think they've done a pretty good job, this is one of those weird situations. If this happens and you're going to make the Denver Broncos do what they did, then I don't care who they have to put out there for the Baltimore Ravens. You have to play this game this week.
I could rock with some RG3 at QB, honestly.
Okay, quick question, and I'll just take your answer off the air. Mm-hmm. This is probably a fast answer. If you were the Dallas Cowboys, Eric Bieniemy or that head coach down south, Norman?
Levi,
Lincoln Riley or Eric Bieniemy? If you really were serious. I get it. Dallas needs to fix their defense. James Conner was the worst, Connor Williams was the worst draft pick ever. That's where everything has gotten jacked up, in my opinion. But anyway, Dallas needs to fix it. You guys can figure that out.
Yeah, thanks for the phone call. Appreciate it. Levi, since you're the designated Cowboys fan, who would you want?
Hey, yeah, I'm the expert in terrible decisions of the Dallas Cowboys. Give me Lincoln Riley all day. Just the mastermind of offense that he has. I think him, and I really honestly think you keep Kellen Moore as your offensive coordinator, because weirdly it seems like the consistent thing is Dak Prescott played really good with Kellen Moore at coordinator in these past 2 years before, of course, he went out this year. So I think Lincoln Riley would hopefully keep him as coordinator, but also if he wants to bring in his own guys, I completely understand. I just think Lincoln Riley would be the perfect head coach in Dallas, and I'm going to be honest with you. I really think the Kansas City Chiefs should just lock up Eric Bieniemy, to be, one, the successor to Andy Reid when Andy Reid's ready to say, all right, I'm done. But also, he might be one of those situations where I think he would be a better assistant coach than head coach. Because there's several of those in the NFL. We could literally bring down a roster. I could say that, Jets, and then we could just get it going. But I also think, wouldn't you just want the best chance of success being a coordinator for the greatest football team in the world right now?
Yes.
That's success.
But the Cowboys would take Eric Bieniemy 1,000 times over. I mean, anybody would. With what he's actually been able to do,
that's
it's scary. I mean, he's a guru. And I know that it's mixed with Andy Reid, and Andy Reid's a big part of it. No, get twisted. But my goodness, what he's done with Patrick Mahomes. Because, I mean, Patrick Mahomes is elite. We know that. And he does things a lot of quarterbacks don't do. But he's elevated his game thanks to Eric Bieniemy.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you this. Well, the Cowboys, because here's the thing. I don't see how the Cowboys keep Mike McCarthy around. I just don't. I know that they've had injuries, and that's a thing, but he has lost leadership of this squad big time. And I think Eric Bieniemy is going to be the Houston Texans' next head coach.
Oh, I could actually see Eric Bieniemy in Houston actually kind of.
They want to pair him up with Deshaun Watson.
I actually feel like that would be a perfect thing. The main thing is they got to make sure with what they do next, they need to get as many offensive linemen as possible and protect Deshaun Watson like he's their first child, because they're paying him like
he's
their first
child. The Chiefs extended Andy Reid. So, you know, he's going to be there. I think he's going to be there as long as possible while Mahomes is there. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're Andy Reid, how even if it's in the ninth year of his contract, it's about up and you say, I can't do it. No, you're going to ride it out for as long as Patrick Mahomes is the quarterback of Kansas City Chiefs. Mm-hmm. So, and Eric Bieniemy, don't get twisted. He's going to be the hottest commodity come this offseason, and he'll be a new head coach.
Please, Dallas, fire Mike McCarthy. I beg of ye.
Hey, the Jags are going to need a new head coach. The Cowboys, maybe. I think they will. The Chargers absolutely need one. The Texans will. There's a lot of positions going to be open this year, and he's going to fulfill one of them, no doubt.
Weirdly enough, I don't think Anthony Lynn's that bad of a coach. I just think maybe in a bad situation. But honestly,
yesterday was a terrible performance.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it was absolutely
bad.
Terrible. Yeah, we come back here on the afternoon sports drive. Take a look at that Chiefs-Bucks game. I mean, it was a really, really good game. And the final score might not do it justice, but man, one receiver who is known around here, Oklahoma State, decided to go nuclear. We'll talk about that to round out the show next. Welcome back. Afternoon Sports Drive. Triple Play Sports Radio Network rounded out the show on this Monday. So much. We got to stretch so much out this week. A lot of good stuff going on in the world of sports. Really busy, busy time. And, you know, I love that promo with the app. Mm-hmm. They play the SpongeBob cut of how many times did I teach you this lesson, old man. One of the most classic SpongeBob scenes ever, right? They just beat the crap out of that old guy. Yeah. they do it twice in the same show. And then it made me think. Because I saw that meme yesterday where Patrick Mahomes basically told Tom Brady, you know, party's over, Grandpa, situation. And it's real. If you look back at that game, okay, the final score, if you watch that game, Chiefs, they could have pulled away a lot more than that. You know, it was a weird kind of Bucks garbage time situation at the end of the game where Tom Brady turned it up a bit. But the interceptions, man, it's not good. He wasn't throwing the ball that well. He made a couple of good throws that were kind of vintage Tom Brady. But the thing I take away from this game, this season, and we've seen it right now, there's an issue with Tom Brady and Bruce Arians. They're not. It's not Tom Brady and Bill Belichick.
Well,
and
Brady, it came out, didn't Brady was calling the play Saturday. Or
yeah,
Sunday,
yeah. I mean, and that's the thing is that from game one, okay, this year, we remember against the Saints, when Brady had that really bad performance against the Saints to start off the season, Bruce Arians was like, hey, you know, he threw some bad picks. When against the Bears this year, when he didn't know what down it was, he said, hey, he should have known what down it was. When it was, you know, a couple weeks ago, hey, Tom Brady's been in the league for 20 years, but he might have been confused by some coverages. Okay, it was like, what? So there's been this back and forth between Bruce Arians, who, by the way, will not budge on Tom Brady, on handing over the reins completely to Tom Brady, which, make no mistake, that's what Bill Belichick ultimately did.
Mm-hmm. What's going to eventually end up happening is the only thing that Bruce Arians most likely will be budging is the door out of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers facility, because most likely what will happen is at the end of the season, after Tampa Bay makes the playoffs, he's going to get fired and you're going to bring in a coach that actually, you know, works well.
You're going to bring in the coach that Tom Brady says we're going to bring in the coach.
Yeah.
I mean, if he can get Bruce Arians out of the way, but at the same time, he's not looking all that good.
I was going to say, does Brady even come back after this?
That's the thing. Is Tom Brady is, and we knew this was going to happen at some point with this year. The offense is not the Patriots' offense. He has elite wide receivers all over the field that like to go down the field and make down the field catches. They didn't do that in the Patriots' offense. Mm-hmm. You hit over the middle of the field with a couple of guys and you dumped it off to your running back. That was it. You didn't have big time playmakers. So that's why it was when Tom Brady decided to choose the Bucs, on paper it was like, whoa, you put Tom Brady with Chris Godwin, Mike Evans, those tight ends, and oh my gosh, they added Leonard Fournette and Antonio Brown. This is gonna be, they're never gonna lose. Well, I mean, Tom Brady, if you look at that system, and it was funny. If you watch that game, Tony Romo, up in the booth, he's talking the whole time about that they need to start getting back to some Patriot-type play. Get that to the Patriots playbook. That's what Tom Brady's used to.
Well, then go get Bill Belichick.
Well, and you can't have those many weapons I just said on that team. You can't and expect to win with Tom Brady, whose arm is no longer there anymore. I'm sorry, it just isn't. And I think what we saw officially, we said this before when Brady and Mahomes met up, we saw again a more of a passing of the torch type thing again. And because Patrick Mahomes, he's the best player on the planet. It's not even funny. He's not even funny. I mean, he's not even close. You know, and I think the Chiefs are the best team. I think they're better than the Steelers. But the problem is their defense has been a little off these last few games. And then the running game has disappeared since they added Le'Veon Bell. And it wasn't there before they added Clyde because Patrick Mahomes can literally throw it the entire game. And it's not really an issue. But what we do take for granted, and I thought it was funny, because yesterday, Tyreek Hill decides to go absolutely nuclear, okay? This dude went off, well over 200 yards. He was, and for some reason, the Bucs decided to go single coverage on him. I don't know what you're thinking in that situation.
Was it the third receiver in NFL history with 200, receiving 200 plus in the first quarter?
Yeah, and you want to know over the Chiefs passing attack? Tyreek Hill leads the league in receiving yards. Do you want to know who's right behind him? Travis Kelce. He's a tight end. They're both on the same team. This team, and it comes down to quarterback play. No one comes close to what Patrick Mahomes does, but the thing is, what still concerns me, as I said there, is I love Tyreek's performance. I thought it was great. I think he's a legitimate top three receiver in the league. The run game is going to have to be there at some point. You have to have some sort of balance here and there. So that's the one thing that still kind of bothers me. But I thought overall, you see Patrick Mahomes throw for over 400 yards, and he did it like it was nothing. If you go back and you look at anything that happened in that game, look how those two, Patrick Mahomes and Tyreek Hill, closed out the game. Very last pass, Mahomes moves out of the pocket, basically creates his own pocket after stepping up and squaring his feet on the near side of the field and squeezes it into Tyreek Hill. There's not a lot of quarterbacks that make that play. I remember when I was listening early, I hope Casey's listening, Casey Kendrick. He was talking earlier in his show, and I heard him out there, that he was kind of going off on Tony Romo saying, oh, Tom Brady just made a Patrick Mahomes-type throw, saying, how could he say that? I mean, Levi, does Patrick Mahomes not make throws that we have seen nobody else make in the NFL, including Tom Brady?
Yeah.
Arm angles, it's just so that right there is something people got to understand. This is next level. But I don't know about you guys. I just think yesterday, I said it before the season when I predicted the Chiefs Bucks coming up in this spot, that the Bucks would win. I said that would be one of the Chiefs' losses this year. If they just handed the Bucks that loss, and could have been a lot bigger, by the way, Mahomes missed a wide open Mecole Hardman for 89 yards, would have been an easy touchdown. So with that being the case, they win this game, and I look at the rest of their schedule. The Saints are easily their next, most competition they have left. They're the best team in the league.
Bro, I'm not going to lie. After what happened to me in fantasy, I don't want to talk a lot about the Chiefs because
Tyreek Hill, yikes.
I'll give them the recap of how I just basically got destroyed by two players in fantasy. This week, I dropped 220 points in our fantasy league, and usually that can secure me a dub almost any other day. Not this weekend because a combo of Patrick Mahomes and Tyreek Hill with two players that all together dropped a total of 120 points. I am down 30 right now.
Yikes. How unfair is it
unbelievable.
That someone in anyone's fantasy league has both Patrick Mahomes and Tyreek Hill?
Yeah. Well, if you think about what happened in fantasy leagues this year, a lot of fantasy leagues, Lamar Jackson still went first in quarterbacks. Mm-hmm. And a lot of fantasy leagues pick quarterbacks in later rounds, and I don't know. I think there were guys that passed up. And then as far as wide receiver, you had Michael Thomas, you had Devontae Adams, you had DeAndre Hopkins all going before Tyreek Hill.
Oh, yeah. I'm just upset. Like, I probably would be set right now if I had Dak Prescott still, if he was still healthy.
Oh, the good times.
It was the good times. If you're a Chiefs fan, this is also a good time because, goodness, the Kansas City Chiefs, it's just, even though I like to say the Pittsburgh Steelers are the top team in the league, Kansas City is either they're also there or they're but I don't
they're beyond Pittsburgh.
Okay,
Pittsburgh
so that's what I was going to ask you, Zach. So you're saying that they're there.
It's my thing.
Pittsburgh's just undefeated.
Right. So you Zach, you're in the boat that Kansas City's the best team in the league. Okay.
Absolutely.
The reason I say it is, and I said this earlier, Levi, in the year. I think last week actually. Is because when you break it down, Kansas City, their offense can outperform anything that their defense puts out there.
Yeah.
You know, their defense can play really, really bad. The Steelers' defense is awesome, and I think it's really tough to score on them at times. But if their offense, and they're going to run into a day where they don't have a great day.
Mm-hmm.
If that's the case and Big Ben's not feeling it all that well, their offense isn't going to be able to get them back into a game like the Chiefs. That's just the difference for me.
Well, that's the thing is Kansas City, their defense can come up with stops. Maybe not consistently.
But all you need is a few, right?
Yeah, and they're not one of the best defenses in the league.
No.
But they're going to come up with 2 to 3 stops when they need it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you have an offense that just can't be stopped, those 2 to 3 stops on defense are going to win you ball games.
And the main thing you also got to think about, and now that I took a few extra seconds to think about, I will also go Kansas City because the other main difference
What a sheep.
Let me give my explanation for a second. Mainly because the other difference between Kansas City and Pittsburgh is Kansas City, this defense, because it's only like 1-2 pieces like Kendall Fuller, and that's honestly about it. The rest of this defense has won a Super Bowl compared to what's on this Pittsburgh Steelers defense.
But to be fair, though, I would take Pittsburgh's defense every day.
Yeah, well, you their defense is better, but what you saw was mainly the same defense as last year that won the Super Bowl. The thing that they did was in the games that they came back, like the Texans, the Titans, and even in the Super Bowl, a lot of that was because of their defense making stops playoffs.
But yeah, and that's where I was leading up to this because this defense is proven to where in the big moments they've proven themselves. This Pittsburgh defense has not. They haven't made the playoffs in the past couple years. So now this is the time where this Pittsburgh defense, if they can put it together and throughout the playoffs and they just start rumbling and stumbling down the line, you could see Pittsburgh rise up to the top, but the offense for Kansas City is limitless, and that defense is good enough to back up the offense, I'll go Kansas City.
Okay, yeah, that's fair.
I'm also a LeJarius Sneed fan.
he's a lot of fun to watch. We're going to round out the show here really quickly with this.
The day is coming to an end. Time to find out if these two got any smarter.
The question is, what did you learn?
Let's find out what the guys learned today on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Well, I learned something today.
What did we learn? Zach, what you got for me?
Two things. One, Sun Bowl canceled. Second longest running bowl game, only behind the Rose Bowl. It's been played 86 consecutive seasons since 1935.
Wow.
And I also learned that the Pac-12's getting screwed because it's the fourth bowl game the Pac-12 has had canceled and the third bowl game that the ACC has had canceled.
Wow.
And then I also learned that College Game Day is going to Coastal Carolina for Coastal Carolina Liberty.
Oh.
One of the best College Game Day destinations of the decade.
Ooh, baby.
Absolutely it is. You know what? I'm going to stick with college football real quick, too, for what I learned. This week, you know, we had Ohio State again. Found out they weren't going to be able to play.
Shocker.
Thanks a lot, Big Ten. Okay, bottom line. I thought about this when I looked back at what we were talking about when the Big Ten made this decision. This is like the most Big Ten karma thing I've ever seen in my life. Mm-hmm. They come back with first of all, the ridiculous decision to ever cancel the season. Then they decide to get it back when it's too late. Their only shot of a representative this year was going to be Ohio State, and they are a couple games away or one game away, I think, from not even being eligible to get in. I mean, it's unbelievable. The Big Ten absolutely screwed Ohio State out of the real shot. And you're telling me that the way it's gone, they're going to get these next two games in? I don't even get me started with the Big Ten.
I think if that happens, I honestly think you'll see the college football playoff tweak some rules.
I think
it'll happen.
It could be.
Yeah, I got two quick.
I think you could see Ohio State with five games.
Wow.
Yeah, I got two quick ones as well, and it basically goes to the Big Ten because I truly think that with what you have left on the schedule in Michigan State and Michigan for Ohio State, Ohio State has a big chance of where they will not be getting into the playoffs, which if I had to pick a team out of this, because to me this is Harbaugh's last year in Michigan, tell me that wouldn't be the biggest, well, I can't ever win, but you're not getting in on my hands and canceling the game.
They're not beating him.
The other thing is the best way to cancel out shipping is by buying enough stuff to make up for the shipping.
That's good. Hey, that is a good what you learned right there.
That's why I got this hat.
There you go. Yeah, he's rocking the Cowboys hat for some reason. He's got a lot
of
guts.
It's because I love sadness.
There you go. Some people do.
That's the only thing I got, man.
Yeah. It's going to do it for us here on the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. That's Zach Lancaster. Fantastic to have him back. That's Levi Peckinpah over there. Appreciate him as always. I'm Patrick Wheeler. We'll be back here tomorrow on the Afternoon Sports Drive again, 3 o'clock, and catch us all here. Until then, everybody have a great Monday.